afternoon you've given us. What a wonderful privilege we have to come to your home, to your house, Lord, to worship your name, Lord, to worship what you are. You are God. You are the only God, Lord. And even then, Lord, we don't deserve, Lord, you sent your Son. For your love for us is such that you gave us Christ Jesus to die for us. Sometimes, Lord, we forget that. Sometimes we continue walking the way that we used to walk, Lord. So help us tonight, Lord, to learn things that we preach you. We wanted to preach Christ and Christ crucified, Lord. We don't want to preach ourselves. So, Lord, we come to you asking you for the special anointing of the Holy Spirit. That you remind us how we should walk and why we should walk that way, Lord. We be careful, Lord, to give you honor and glory, Lord. I ask you, Lord, that if any heart here is heavy by problems and situations, that you, as you promised, Lord, as we come to you, Lord, you will give us peace. The peace that surpasses all human understanding. So we will be careful, Lord, to give you honor and glory to you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. To the Lord. I don't know about anybody else. I just know about Carlos. Very complicated person. And like many people, the Lord came to rescue me in a moment of crisis. I do have the tendency, and you have heard me say this before, to analyze everything. To not believe everything that they tell me, and to just to try to find out for myself if what people are telling me is really true. So I came to the Lord, and right away I knew that the answers were not from men, it was from God. I'm going to repeat that again. The answers don't come for your life. Don't come from men, come from God. But we do have a problem when we come to the Lord. That we are totally, if you are anything like me, I was totally ignorant about anything about the Word of God and everything. So I dedicated myself to study the Word of God, and I was blessed by somebody rich in love for me and discipled me. I am a real believer in the need to be discipled. We have to be very careful as we learn the Word of God. And this man of God, he started directing me in a way that I was able to understand and trust. He didn't give me answers. He directed me to the Scriptures. And he gave me some scriptures to read and to ask God to reveal to me what really was trying to say to me, but not to my intellect, to my spirit. I want to make a parenthesis here. I want to read 1 Thessalonians 5:23. 1 Thessalonians 5:23. Says the following: "In the very God of peace, sanctify you wholly. And I pray to God, your Holy Spirit, in soul and body, He preserve blameless until the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. All Paul is talking to the church of Thessalonica, and all the ministry of Paul was directed to Greek people. Greek people, to this day, they have the tendency to be very intellectual. All the big philosophers come from there. And Paul is trying to direct this church, this group of believers, to the truth about the relationship with God, to the way that we're supposed to have contact and communion with God. As you can read in that verse, Paul is making a point that all of us are made out of three parts, so to speak. My body, this is my body. My soul, which is where the emotions and my intellect are. And my spirit, which is the deepest part of the inner man. Now, when you and I came to the Lord, you probably heard that when you come to the Lord, everything becomes new. Things, the old things has passed away, and behold, everything is new. And I knew that something, I had to understand something there, because I knew that my body was the same. I had the same ugly face, and I had the same tendencies. So I really got into that, because I wanted to understand what is it that God really, this thing called Christianity, is about. Now, you hear many times people say to you, is it the Lord told me, that the Lord revealed me, that the Lord this, and the Lord that. Now, when I was very new, I had a tendency to look at people and I said, sure. Because sometimes it's true, sometimes it's the emotional part of the believer that is taking over. So I really wanted to understand this part, that when you are born again, you are born of the Spirit. You are not born again physically. You are not born again intellectually. Now please pay attention to that. I still had the same ideas when I came to the Lord. But the gift of God to me is that He gave me a new spirit to come to dwell in me, within me, the Holy Spirit, to come and dwell, to teach my spirit the things that I had to learn. We have to be very careful with that. We have to be very careful, because I have heard many, many, many things in the church. And I'm kind of concerned about that. I believe that this church is going to be invaded, so to speak, by a lot of new people. It is happening in a small congregation in Spanish. A lot of people are coming. And every Sunday, you know, we continue getting new people. And I pray to the Lord to give me someone of these members that we already have to help me to disciple the new people. I don't want the people to come to church and sing some songs and do some things, you know, and feel some emotions and go home and continue being the same person. I don't think that's what God is calling us to. I believe that the Great Commission is not to make converts. The Great Commission is to make disciples. It's very clear that what the Lord says, you are going to teach them what you have learned from me, and you're going to make disciples of all nations. You are not going to try to bring people just for the convenience to see a church full of people. We have a tremendous responsibility in front of God to make disciples. Now, let me say to you very kindly, not to be scared or anything like that, and I'm not trying to reproach anybody, please. Understand that you cannot follow Jesus if you don't become his disciple. You cannot follow Jesus if you cannot deny yourself. You cannot follow Jesus if you don't deny yourself in the Spirit. Because everything follows that. If you don't understand that, if you've been trying to follow Jesus with your own intellect, you are not really following Jesus. Because Jesus is God, God is a spirit, and those that worship Him and follow Him have to follow Him in spirit and in truth. Now, let me give you another scripture that is very well known by the church. Paul is talking to Timothy. And in the first epistle, the second epistle to Timothy, Paul says, all the scriptures is inspired by God and profitable to teaching, for reproof, for correction, for training in righteousness. Very well known verse. And then he continues saying that the man of God may be adequate and equipped for every good work. Now I really wanted to exhort you. This teaching is going to be about 2 or 3 weeks. So we're going to go slow because I would like to people to really grasp the importance of following Jesus in the Spirit. The importance to realize that what is becoming new in Carlos is the Spirit inside of me. I don't have time, but I'm going to recommend to you to read the second chapter of the first epistle to the Corinthians. When Paul went to that church, he came and he says, I didn't come with my intellect. I didn't come with my what I know. I came inspired by God. He says, so your faith won't be, it won't rest in the intellect of man or anything that the man gave you, but in the power of God. Now, here again, I'm not taking nobody's inventory. I'm just giving you, because it happened to me, that I was trying to be good. I was trying to be really good. You know what I mean? I came to church, I'm saved. Now I'm a good boy. Hallelujah. And then I found myself that I could do it. I was good for about 3 weeks after I received the Lord. And then I began to see that it was wearing out. And one day you guys heard me say this, one day I really exploded. And then the person that was trying to help me, guide me, to explain to me what was happening to me. Are you frustrated with your life? Are you frustrated that things don't seem to change? That you have asked God, please help me, because I cannot do this anymore. Are you asking that in the flesh, or are you asking that in the Spirit? That's the question. Because if you're asking that in the flesh, well, you don't have to sit down to wait. If you're asking that in the Spirit, that's a different thing. Let me make a parenthesis. God created the heavens and the earth. Right in the beginning of the Bible. And the Spirit of God moved about the surface of the earth. And the earth was void without form, and it was in darkness. And because the power of the Holy Spirit was moving, God said, let it be light, and the light was day. And if you study the Bible with care, not as a history book, you see God immediately putting order in the creation. They start putting things in order, one after the other, one after the other. And on the seventh day, God saw what He created, and He said, it was good. He created man, He created us in His image. not physically, spiritually. God is a spirit, and he created Adam as a spiritual being, so in order for him to have communion with God. Otherwise, no way that Adam could talk to God. I mean, you realize that, or you think that God was just like a Johnny Wismuller, all those that we are all, Johnny Wismuller was the first person in the movies. That, you know, he was a handsome man walking in the jungle. But no, Adam was a spiritual being with the image of God. He was able to talk to God face to face. He lost that when he sinned. He lost the image of God because God is holy, and nothing that is not holy can be in the presence of God. That's why we cannot be in the presence of God in the flesh. Now let me make the other observation. When Nicodemus came that night to talk to Jesus and had the conversation that he had with him, he came with expectations that he was going to give a religious answer, because Nicodemus was a religious man. He knew a lot about the law. He was a doctor in the law. And when he asked the question to Jesus, in trying to see who really he was, the Lord didn't answer. He just said this: "Truly, truly, I said to you that if you are not born again, you are not able to see the kingdom of God." Now that word "see" is synonymous with understanding. You don't see, you don't understand the kingdom of God. You cannot perceive that because you are in the flesh. Nobody here, including me, including everybody in the world, can understand God in the flesh. Let's stop trying to have conversations with God in the flesh. The exhortation that Brother Ben gave us tonight, it is very true. You can know what you can sing, but you can also sing in the spirit, which is different. You can pray, but you have to learn to pray in the spirit. You can love, but you have to love with the love that God gives you, which is a spiritual love, etc., etc., etc. In the conversation that he had with Nicodemus, he says in that same chapter, verse 6, he says, "Truly I tell you to you that what is flesh is flesh, what is a spirit is a spirit." You cannot add anything spiritual to the flesh. I'm going to repeat that again. You cannot become better flesh. And I can prove it to you spiritually, I mean, but biblically. Because when Paul said in chapter 7 in the book of Romans that he was confused with the fact that he wanted to do good and he couldn't do the good, but the bad that he wanted not to do, he did not do it. He said, "Who can deliver me from this body of death?" Meaning the flesh. And when he enters in chapter 8 of the book of Romans, he says, "But there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus." And then he adds, "Those who walk according to the Spirit and not according to the flesh." And he continues saying, "Because walking in the Spirit is life, and walking in the flesh is death." Is he talking about spiritual death? Yes, he's talking about spiritual death. That's why you see so many people dead in the church. That's why the prophet Isaiah, and then Jesus repeated in another way. He said, Isaiah said this, "Having ears, and they don't hear. Having eyes, and they don't see." That's why you hear. You see, when you start really seriously studying the scriptures, You see the Lord Jesus Christ under the power of the Holy Spirit healing people with specific sicknesses. The blind, the mute, the deaf, the paralytic, the leper. All those things represent spiritual things. And we won't have that tonight. But what I'm trying to tell you is this. Just to say one. When all of us came to the Lord, we came guided by somebody, so to speak, because we were going to come to the presence of God and we were blind. We couldn't see that. We were killing ourselves by our attitudes, by our feelings, by our emotions, by things that we didn't want to do, we continue to do it. That could have been alcoholism, drug addiction, pornography, you name it. Hate, envy. And you wanted to stop it, you couldn't. And then God opened your eyes. And for the first time, the first thing that God does to you is to be able to see yourself as you really are. Now nobody has to tell you absolutely nothing. Now God is telling you, because as you come to the Lord, God makes no exception of persons. He delivered to everybody, the presence of the Holy Spirit in your life. And then that Holy Spirit starts really taking care of things inside of you in such a way that you become very uncomfortable when you're doing something wrong. But it's not enough to feel uncomfortable. Then the process of sanctification starts. That's why Paul says, please, by the mercies of God, don't compromise with the world. Don't be conformed to this world. But let the Holy Spirit renew you in the spirit of your mind. Now we really have to get serious about this. I had a problem not too long ago with somebody. I called the attention to that person as to the way that this person was talking about other people. And I said, you cannot teach, you cannot preach, you cannot do anything in the church unless you correct the way that you express yourself about other people. Because you are in the flesh. And I, for one, I won't allow that. I'm not a tyrant or anything like that. Well, I'm going to repeat. What is of the flesh is flesh. What is of the spirit is spirit. You cannot preach, you cannot correct anything when you behave in the flesh. I don't know, I want to repeat this. If you had that occasion when somebody told you, say, God told me this and God told me that. Even when somebody brings a word of God, I'm very keen in my listening to try to discern what God is really good saying. Now, God, by the same nature, can be saying one thing to my brother there and another thing to me. God is perfect. There are many things that we won't be able to understand with our mind. You know, I don't know if you happen to see things that you see in the television. I hope that every day we see that less and less of famous men of God, and all of a sudden they find themselves in a real mess. And my wife had a hard time with that. And I keep saying to my wife, keep your eyes on the Lord, the author, and the finishing of your faith. Don't put the eyes on men. I don't care who it is. Don't put your eyes in me, and I won't put my eyes in you. My eyes have to be fixed on Him. And my eyes have to be the spiritual eyes. I cannot afford to get the old Carlos to try to analyze your behavior in the flesh, because you're going to be in a lot of trouble. If you are doing that in your marriage, if you are doing that in your situation, whatever that is, you are in a lot of trouble. You have to sit down with the Lord and through prayer and meditation to ask God to guide us to the power of the Holy Spirit to see what is really behind that situation that you're going to do. Never mind the wise, you know, for Him to reveal to you. Because the Word of God says, if I maintain myself in the Spirit, in the Word of God, not with my intellect, but in the Spirit, in His Scriptures, God will reveal the truth, and the truth will make me free. And then He says, it will make me free indeed. I want to be free of Carlos. I'm going to say things here tonight that, please understand that I'm not trying to take nobody's inventory, okay? Because you're dealing with a guy here that has made all the mistakes that a person can make in life. So I kind of know what I'm talking about. Don't blame people for your things. It's time to stop blaming other people for what happened to me. Now that I'm a Christian, now I really start seeing Paul says, forgetting the things that are behind. Now I fix my sight in what the Lord wants to do with Carlos. There is no way that the Carlos of 1978 and back can be the same person that is here tonight talking to you. There's no way. Because I wanted to be here. I wanted to be here because one day the Lord started revealing to me the beauty of the Word of God and the joy of my salvation. And I'm beginning to see what a treasure He has given to me. And I said, oh God, I have to talk to people about this. I still feel chills when I talk about that. Salvation is such a beautiful thing when you begin to realize from where God got you. And I'm not talking about that I was a skipper. Forget about that. No, I'm talking about the way that I was feeling inside. And all of a sudden, He came. And He gave me peace. And I never ever had that feeling before in my life. Now, I'm going to stop right here and make a parenthesis. Feeling and how can I put it? Feeling and those kind of emotions are of the flesh. You have to be very careful as you continue growing in this. Feelings are of the flesh. That's why when you read in Philippians 4, 6, and 7, it says, the peace of God that surpasses all human understanding. It has nothing to do with your intellect. Now it's in another dimension. It's a spiritual dimension. And you and I, prior to coming to the Lord, you and I never went through that moment of peace of God. Now the enemies want to come, and your flesh wants to come to rob you of that. The old man wants to get up again and take over. And I'm here to tell you tonight that we have to be on guard. Proverbs 20:27 says the following. The spirit of man is the candle of the Lord, searching all the inward parts of the heart. Now, I'm going to make a parenthesis here where you, when you are a senior student of the Word of God, go to the book of Nehemiah. Nehemiah is titled the Holy Spirit. He represents the Holy Spirit. When he received the call to go and restore the walls of Jerusalem, it's the same call that he gets in each one of us to restore the wall of our soul. When we come to the Lord, our soul has got no walls to defend the inner man. And as you see, when he gets to Jerusalem, the first thing that he does is to go and do an inspection of the walls of Jerusalem. And he goes and he realizes that it's a big job. Well, now let me go back to you and to me, that when the Lord sends us the Holy Spirit, he goes, the first thing that he does is to inspect my walls. And he starts seeing why the enemy can go through here or can go through there, and he begins to restore those walls. And the way that he restores those walls is with the Word of God. And the Word, they restore the walls of the soul, is through the body of Christ. Members of the church has to wake up to the spiritual responsibility that God has given us. Because I believe there is a lot of Lone Rangers in the church today that they come for their own thing and that's it. They live a living with the horse. And God has called us to help each other. That's what the Word of God says in the book of Hebrews, that we have to encourage one another to love and to good works. When you see somebody that you care, you have to care enough to confront. To confront in love. To confront in such a way with the wisdom of God that this person wake up. There are people that have heard many lies. There are people that have heard a lot of Bible in the flesh. There are people that have heard a lot of religion. But I'm here to tell you, not because I'm saying it, that we have to hear the voice of the Holy Spirit. That's why it's so incredibly, tremendous responsibility to be here. I'm scared to be here. Because it's not that I'm going to be vain or anything. No, it's the fact that I have to preach the truth. Because the truth is what makes people free. You know, you see people going to this and that. And I have to tell you this, for example. You have a situation in your home. There is nothing that you can do other than the physical things that make sense sometimes to do. But to change the person that you are dealing with, your wife, your son, your brother-in-law, your brother, you cannot change that person because you are telling them to change. It won't happen. It won't happen. We all have addictions. All of us. Can be television, can be games, can be a lot of things. Can be food, can be whatever. And you cannot change anybody or that unless you try to bring that person to the realization that whatever that person needs first and most before anything is to come to God and to give his or her life to God. Other than that, there is nothing that you can do. It sounds terrible what I'm saying. You're going to love them and everything, and you're going to see people destroying their lives, and you wish to do the best you can. And unless that person comes to God, it won't happen. Now, let me say to you this. One day I was talking to somebody, and he said, I stopped drinking without the help of God. And I said, oh, wonderful. But you are still the same person. And that, I don't want that. I wanted to have peace. I don't want to stop drinking. That's what I drank. Because I didn't have peace. And when I drank, I ran away. Drugs and alcohol were my medicine, if you know what I mean. Because I ran away from reality. I don't like this reality. So I get stoned, I get drunk in such a way that I pass out. The problem is that the medicine becomes the problem. But, so the spirit of man is the candle of the Lord. Now, through that spirit, the Lord is going to inspect the inner man. And he's going to start guiding you. And you're going to start being aware that there are some things within you that has to be not corrected. You're going to say, Brother Carlos, you're really doing it to me tonight. You don't correct the flesh, you die. You know, you just don't correct the flesh. Flesh, the problem with the flesh is like a cancer. There's no cure for that part. You really have to really die. This is going to take a long time, this teaching, so be patient with me, please. Have you died? Only you can answer that. Paul says, what shall we say? Shall we continue sinning so the grace of God will abound? And he says, no. Don't you realize that he who followed Jesus, and he, remember that I told you that in order to follow Jesus, you have to deny yourself and pick up your cross, right? Do you think that that's, oh yeah, glory to God, hallelujah. No. You pick up your cross to go to Calvary. Not to be a religious fanatic, no. You pick up your cross and you follow Jesus to Calvary. Calvary is a place to death. And you crucify yourself and you die there. So, just like Jesus, when he resurrected after day, you're going to be resurrected when you go and get baptized. And as you come out a new creation. The old carnal stays there. And he's going to rot it there. But the new Carlos is the one that comes out of the water and say, now I'm a new creation. And now is the only way that I can follow Jesus, because I cannot deny myself in the flesh. It is impossible for me. And God is telling me to my Savior, Carlos, you want to follow me? Deny yourself. He says, what do you mean? Everything that you want, you have to deny yourself, because everything that you were wishing and doing is sin. And now you're going to begin to see how difficult it is to deny yourself. I don't think that anybody can do it in the flesh. I really don't. Maybe there are people stronger than me. I'm talking about denying the purpose. What do you mean, Brother Carlos, denying the purpose? I don't want to be a monk. I don't want to go into the mountain and get in a monastery and deny myself of all the things just for doing that. No, I want to deny myself and be useful. I want to be a testimony of what God does in a person. I wanted to say yes, it really means yes, and say no, it really means no. There is no such thing as maybe. See, it's radical. It's radical. I'm here to submit to you tonight before we go into another point that you don't know yourself. I can prove it in the Bible. Lord, I won't deny you. Even if everybody leave you, I won't leave you. And the Lord look at him with care. He says, oh, Peter. And I'm going to paraphrase this conversation. You really don't know what you're talking about, Peter. You don't know yourself. You are impressed like everybody else by the signals that I made. You saw me walking in the water. You saw me walking, making the miracle of the 5,000. You saw me bringing to life Lazarus and goodness. But when it comes to die, you don't know yourself. You saw me intellectually, Peter, and you say, wow, this man really has it. He really is doing it. But you don't understand what I'm doing. And Peter said, no, 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 no. Like I have said, no, 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 I won't do that, and I end up doing it. So, we all know the story. The night after, he denied himself, Jesus three times. And then it comes the reconciliation. Chapter 17 of the book of John. Peter, do you love me? Yes, I care for you, Lord. Peter, do you love me? But you know that I really have a great feeling for you. But he's not answering the question, really, when you see the original. He cannot say love. So in the original, the third question that the Lord asked is, Peter, do you really care for me? Lord, you know that I really care for you. He went down to the level of Peter. And he didn't say, you deny me. You didn't. No, Lord, God is love. Tremendous passage. And then he says to him, follow me, Peter. And then Peter turns around and sees John coming at a distance. And to show you that Peter is still the same person, Lord, what about this one? And it's a beautiful, when you see the original, what the Lord said to Peter, it's so beautiful. He said, it's not your business. What do you care? You follow me. What a liberating thing is that statement. I don't follow the Lord for what Mary does or anybody does. I follow the Lord because he, I got a call from him. I cannot make an inventory of the lives of anybody. They're always going to come short. Now I have to care what the Lord is asking from me. I'm responsible in front of God because God gave me the biggest treasure that God can give anybody. Not only eternal life, but he gives me his nature. He made me a spiritual being again. Have you ever thought about that? Now that although I walk in the flesh, I'm not of the flesh, Paul says. Or the life that I live now, says, I live by faith in that one who loved me and gave his life for me. It's taking a long time. I'm a slow learner. I don't know about you. The more I study the Bible, the more I'm convinced how much I need it. I'm going to say things here not to impress anybody, because with all due respect to all of you, I really don't care if you get impressed or not. I just want to tell you about me, about my life. Yesterday, I got up at 3:30 in the morning to pray and to ask God to help me about something that I'm going through. And I can, in everything that I've just been telling you tonight, I don't know how to go through. I have to ask God for wisdom from above. Yes, like the Bible is telling me. If anybody lacks wisdom, ask God. I have to recognize that I don't know. That if I do it the way that I think, I'm going to make a mistake. So I got up and I start praying. I prayed for a while, then I start finishing this study. Saturday morning I came and I prayed an hour here. I'm telling you, I'm not here to impress you. I'm here to tell you as to how much I need this guidance. We're going to go through different things about really what is to become new creation. I'm going to deal first in the next coming week, and probably the next one, as to the steps that I have to take to go to that metamorphosis, to become at the image of God. I don't talk physically, I'm talking spiritually. See, let me give you an example as to how careful I have to be when I study the Bible. There is no one person here tonight that doesn't know John 3:16. Right? One day I stopped. I said, okay, let me see what this is about. And I didn't get the word that God so loved the world. And that word so loved stopped me. What did that really mean, so loved? What is trying to describe with the soul love? Do you so love your son, your daughter, your wife? Because so love, it means really that God ignored everything that I had done wrong. It's not to say, well, let me see, Carlos did this, did that. No, he so loved me. The solo covered, that the Word of God says, multitude of sins. And I don't want to even cover one or another person. They wrong me and they're going to pay. So you have to revert. You have to go running to God and say, God, help me. I'm about to commit murder again. Spiritually. So I want to exhort you to come next week. Next week my brother Ben preaches. Yeah? Well, he says, come next week. I love this guy. And we're going to go to this. And we're going to have fun. And we're going to come to some realities that could deliver us. Because the principle is this: you shall know the truth, and the truth will make you free. You shall know the truth to be punished. You shall know the truth to be free. And if you get, when you get home, go into the dictionary and see what it means, indeed. And you will be surprised. May God bless you and keep you. Amen. Heavenly Father, we praise you. We glorify you, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for the beauty of your word, for the confrontation that you've given us through that powerful word, Lord. It's so clear to see the truth in ourselves when we study and meditate in your word, Lord. Help us, Lord. You proclaim in your word that without you we can do nothing. And we believe that. We ask you to help us, Lord, to deny ourselves, to be totally committed to the study of your word, Lord. Baptize us, Lord, as we're going to come to study what is really to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Lord, we ask you to prepare our hearts for that beautiful gift that you have prepared for us, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We're going to receive the offering.